Welcome to the Dole Institute of Politics. My name is Martin Doherty, and I'm a member of the Dole Institute's Student Advisory Board, the official student group of the Institute. The Student Advisory Board is a bipartisan group whose members can access many great opportunities through their involvement with the Institute, including volunteer programs and networking with our special guests. If you are a student and would like to join, please contact us by emailing dolesab@ku.edu. or speaking with a student worker after the program. After the presentation, we will have some time for the audience to ask questions. If you have a question, please raise your hand, and as a student worker with a microphone will come to you. Please stand if you are able to, and ask just one brief question. If you have difficulty hearing during the program, please alert one of our staff members or student volunteers who will assist you. Before we begin, I'd like to remind you to please turn off your cell phones. And now, please join me in welcoming Associate Director, Dr. Barbara Ballard.
Thank you very much. I think most of you know we always have a student do our introductions for us in the evening if you're new at the Dole Institute. I will say good evening and welcome to the Dole Institute of Politics and today's Presidential Lecture Series program, The United States and the Great War, 100 Years Later. This event is the first in a four-part series, and we hope that you will join us next Thursday at 7 p.m. for part two of this lecture series. Tonight's lecture is titled America's Road to War with Dr. Michel Neiberg. About 1 year ago, Bill Lacey decided that the Dole Institute should focus this year's presidential lecture series on World War I. 2017 is the 100th anniversary of the U.S. entry into the war. And unlike World War II, many individuals are unfamiliar with our country's role in the war and the impact it had on our nation. Director Lacey approached KU Professor Emeritus Ted Wilson and asked if he would help us put together a four-part series. He agreed. We were delighted. And he has done a fabulous job as our historical consultant. Ted has worked with the Institute on a number of projects, including an amazing conference on GIs in World War II. He also sparked the creation of our highly popular Fort Leavenworth series. If you have not attended the Leavenworth series on the afternoon, you should. People rave about it. We hope you will enjoy tonight's program. I will just say, we just had dinner with them, and I think you are in for a special treat this evening. Think of what you know about World War I, and then hear from the experts and see if you still know what you thought you knew when they started. But we are delighted that you are with us this evening to kick off our first program for this semester, and I would like to ask you to join me in welcoming Ted Wilson tonight to introduce our series and tonight's special guest. Ted.
Thank you for that generous introduction, Barbara. I've described as the consultant for this series. I always think of myself as the over the hill historian who was involved. But as our nation approaches the 100th anniversary of the entry of the United States into the maelstrom that was World War I, I'm pleased and honored to welcome you to the Dole Institute of Politics for the first of four lectures treating the experience of America and Americans in what was then termed the Great War, a struggle that began in Europe in late July 1914 and which morphed into a global conflict which America entered on April 2nd, 1917. When Bill Lacey invited me to organize this lecture series, I immediately thought of Michel Neiberg, arguably the premier U.S.-based scholar of World War I. Mike now holds the appointment as inaugural chair in War Studies at the U.S. Army War College. I thought of Mike to begin our exploration of this pivotal period in our history. I followed Mike's career since as a recently anointed PhD, Carnegie Mellon University, 1996. His first book, Making Citizen Soldiers, ROTC and the Ideology of American Military Service, was published by Harvard University Press in 2000. While serving on the faculties of the U.S. Air Force Academy, the University of Southern Mississippi, and since 2011, the Army War College, his scholarship is focused on World War I, with occasional explorations of World War II and other periods, from a breathtaking range of perspectives. Over the past 16 years, Mike has authored or edited 12 books and essays and scholarly articles beyond count on World War I topics, including Foch, Supreme Commander in the Great War, which was published in 2003, Fighting the Great War, A Global History, 2005, The Western Front and the Second Battle of the Marne, 2008, and a remarkable book, Dance of the Furies, Europe and the Outbreak of War in 1914, published in 2011, to name but a few. Tonight, Professor Neiberg brings to you the story of how and why Americans moved from being appalled observers of Europe's descent into the abyss in 1914, or partisans for one or another side, to grudging acceptance and in some quarters jubilation when President Woodrow Wilson went to Congress on April 2, 1917 to ask for a declaration of war. His just published study of the transformation that took the United States into the war, The Path to War, How the First World War Created Modern America, published last year. As one reviewer noted, quote, traces the U.S.'s journey from detached observer to fully committed participant in the First World War with great skill and clarity. Based upon extensive research in archives, newspapers, and hitherto unknown personal papers, to which I personally can testify, having witnessed Mike mine the holdings in our Spencer Research Library for World War I related recollections of ordinary Americans during a visit to Lawrence 3 years ago. His work offers a unique perspective regarding the experience of America and the American people during a time of sweeping change. I'm certain that you will both enjoy and learn much from Mike Neiberg's presentation this evening. Please join me in welcoming our distinguished speaker, Professor Michael Neiberg.
You're too kind. Well, good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming out on this very cold night. I want to thank Representative Ballard. I want to thank Ted. Those of you who don't know, Ted is a giant in the field of military history. Ted told me just a little while ago he has completed his 56th PhD student. That includes several close friends of mine. So, Ted, thank you. I also want to thank Angie, if she's around somewhere, for all the administrative help in getting me out here through some pretty complicated travel and logistics. What I'd like to do tonight is talk about a little part of that book that Ted mentioned. What I want to do is take a look at a topic that I think that we as a group of historians have frankly not covered particularly well. There has not been a lot of study about this period in American history, this move from 1914 to 1917. There has been a lot of study of Woodrow Wilson. There has been a lot of study of some of the people around him, and there has been a lot of repeating of the same old historical arguments. My book looks bottom up, and as Ted mentioned, looks at ordinary Americans. It doesn't take away Woodrow Wilson, but it tries to contextualize and understand Wilson's decision-making through the prism of the American people themselves. So what I'd like to do here is present a couple of ideas from that book, and leaving some time at the end for any questions that you might have. What I'd like to do is take you on a little bit of a journey, and the journey that I want to take you on is exemplified best by this man. This is Walter Hines Page, a North Carolina newspaperman and later ambassador to Great Britain. He was an early supporter of Woodrow Wilson's, and Wilson sent him to London as the U.S. ambassador with no inkling that a great European war was about to happen. When that war broke out, Walter Hines Page wrote this letter to the president. "Now and ever I thank heaven for the Atlantic Ocean. Thank God we are out of it." In other words, what Page called the great smash-up was somebody else's business. Americans will help, we'll try to alleviate the suffering where we can, but this doesn't belong to us. By October 1915, he writes Wilson a second letter, and note the tone of this letter. "If Germany wins, the Monroe Doctrine will be shot through. We shall have to have a great army and navy," and here Page did not mean that as a good thing. He meant the United States would have to start spending money on something it had never spent a lot of money on before. "But suppose that England wins. We shall then have merely an academic dispute with her. It is a matter of life or death for English-speaking civilization." And what I want to do in the next half an hour, 35 minutes or so, is walk you through that journey of Page's, from the belief that this war had nothing to do with the United States to the belief that it was literally a matter of life or death. Now, I think Walter Hines Page was ahead of the American people because he was so deeply involved in this, but I think he's representative of where the American people are by the spring of 1917. Page tried very hard to get Woodrow Wilson to see what he, Page, was seeing. And Page wasn't alone. The American ambassador to France, the American ambassador to Germany, the American ambassador to the Austro-Hungarian Empire were all reporting more or less the same thing. In the summer of 1916, Page decided to come to the United States and demand an audience with the president, which is an ambassador's prerogative to do. Wilson wouldn't see him. So Page went to Wilson's summer home on the New Jersey shore and waited on the president's front porch to try to get a minute of the president's time. Wilson gave him just that minute of his time. So what I'd like to do is take you on that journey, and like I said, I'd like to dispel a couple of these kind of ideas that we have kept in our heads about what America was like in this time period and what it was doing in relation to the war. And the first thing that I would like to dispel, you're going to see a lot of Pennsylvania examples. I apologize, but I am a Pennsylvanian, so I guess I don't apologize. The first thing that I want to dispel is that the American people were somehow not paying attention to this war. They were paying attention to everything. The newspapers are full of news about what's happening in Europe. Americans knew that what was going on in Europe was affecting their lives. The outbreak of the First World War was so traumatic that it shut down the New York Stock Exchange from early August until Thanksgiving of 1914, for reasons that had to do with gold being taken out of the United States that I can explain if anybody really wants to hear it in the question and answer. It's boring, but it's interesting to people like me. Newspaper reporters like Richard Harding Davis, a good friend of Theodore Roosevelt's, probably the best-known international correspondent in the United States, went to Europe. I'm going to give you an example of another person who did this as well, and reported very carefully and in great detail about what they were seeing in Europe. I'm going to use somebody other than Davis as my example here. Nor did the American people react the way President Wilson said he wanted them to, neutral in thought and deed. From the very beginning, American sympathies were with France, Belgium, and to a lesser extent, Great Britain. And that's true almost across the spectrum, with some exception in the Irish and German communities, which I'll talk about a little bit. Until 1917, however, the vast majority of Americans hoped to keep their country out of it. They wanted the Allies to win, they were happy to support the Allies, but they didn't see it as America's fight. This view also meant that the American people had no trouble with Woodrow Wilson's economic definition of neutrality. The way Wilson defined neutrality, the American people were free to trade with whomever they wanted. That policy naturally benefited Great Britain and France. It also meant that the economic definitions that America was functioning under overlapped neatly with their, what they saw as their moral obligation. Now, the reporter I want to introduce you to is this woman, Mary Roberts Reinhart, then known as the American Agatha Christie, maybe the most famous female writer of her time in 1914. Her books have not really held up all that well over time, so she's not terribly well read today or very often read today. But in 1914, she was offered the chance to go to the Western Front for the Saturday Evening Post at a fancy dinner party that was being held in Midtown Manhattan. She would be the first woman allowed into the trenches of the Western Front, and the Saturday Evening Post had arranged for her to go to England, the Netherlands, Belgium, France, and Germany. Her husband, at this party, defied her to go. She stood up at the party and said, as in the loudest voice she could, "I do not intend to let the biggest thing of my life go by without having been a part of it." The Saturday Evening Post offered her what was then the most money ever offered to a journalist, $1,000 per dispatch in 1914 dollars. Her husband told the Saturday Evening Post that if they would take a $10,000 life insurance policy on her, he would withdraw his objection, which is what they did. She left in late 1914. She went into the Western Front. She went into the trenches, and she came back in March of 1915. And in some ways, her journey typifies the views of many of the American people, and I want to cover four themes that come up in those pieces of hers. One, she went to Europe intending to condemn both sides. How could you Europeans have been so stupid? Within a couple of weeks of arriving in Europe, however, she had concluded that it was the Germans who were responsible for the outbreak of this war, that all France had been doing was defending its own borders. Second, she was no cipher. Like Richard Harding Davis and some of the other American journalists who went to Europe, they mistrusted the British. They figured that the British were trying to use the Americans for propaganda purposes. And they knew that many of the British propaganda sources coming out of Belgium were wrong, were falsified. So Mary Roberts Rinehart, Richard Harding Davis, and others told their American readers, "Don't believe what the British are telling you. Believe the atrocities that we have seen with our own eyes." Mostly the burning of the city of Leuven, which Americans saw personally when the Allies temporarily recaptured it. Third, she saw clearly on that America had a clear strategic interest in the Allies winning the war, but that the United States, Britain, and France had different visions for what post-war Europe would look like. Therefore, if the United States were to get involved in the war, it had to do so for American reasons, not to help the British and the French exclusively. And fourth, by the time she came back in March of 1915, she was convinced that for American interests to survive, the German army had to be defeated, but that that defeat should be done by the British, French, and to a lesser extent, the Russians. In 1915, she still wanted America's contributions to be charitable, economic, and industrial. Now, she came back to the United States just before the sinking of the Lusitania. And the number of times over the course of this First World War centenary that I have heard one media person or another talk about the Lusitania being the reason the U.S. gets involved in the war, starting to get a little frustrating. The Lusitania is in the spring of 1915. It is, of course, 2 years later that the United States gets involved in the First World War. But the Lusitania was a critical moment for Mary Roberts Rinehart and many others, and here's why. The Lusitania proved to the American people that what Mary Roberts Rinehart and others had been writing was true, that this war was going to affect them, and that the time had now come in the spring of 1915 to make a decision about what to do about it. Now, Americans did not at all agree on the answers to these questions. But the real key of the Lusitania is that it put them front and center inside American discourse, and it helped to lead to this conclusion that Walter Hines Page had reached by October of 1915, that the war was coming to impact the United States, whether the Americans wanted it to or not. One way that this discussion happens is by looking globally at what the United States sees when it looks at countries like Germany. And I found this cartoon from the New York Tribune in October 1915, and I was kind of stunned by it when I first saw it. This is in response to the massacre in Armenia. Right? This cartoon does not blame the Ottomans, it blames the Germans. This is the Kaiser wearing an Ottoman fez and carrying a blood-soaked scimitar. And the caption reads, "Alle mit uns," which is a takeoff on the Gott mit uns, God is with us, which was on the belt buckles of the German soldiers. Throughout 1915 and into early 1916, American attitudes towards Germany got harsher and harsher and harsher. In part because of the news coming out of Belgium, in part because of the Lusitania, in part because of Armenia, and in part because of things that were going on inside the United States as well. There was a German government sabotage campaign against the United States. Attempts to blow up railroad bridges, attempts to blow up shipping, There's a wonderful case. The first wiretap of a telephone in American history is the New York City Police Department trying to figure out who was putting sulfur bombs inside American shipping, European shipping coming out of American ports, I should say. There was the attempted assassination of J.P. Morgan by a German in Long Island. That same man put a bomb in the vice president's office in the Capitol building. If you go to Jersey City, New Jersey today, you'll see a beautiful park there, Liberty State Park. In 1916, that was the primary transit point for American munitions coming from Pennsylvania, Ohio, Indiana, Chicago, to Europe. In the summer of 1916, while the Battle of the Somme was going on, German agents blew Black Tom up in the most costly act of terrorism before 9/11. Not coincidentally, the New Jersey 9/11 Memorial is in that park. Also in 1916, Wilson finally declared two German diplomats, Karl Boy Ed and Franz von Papen, keep those names in mind, please, declared them persona non grata and ordered them sent back to Germany. Franz von Papen later became the last German chancellor before Adolf Hitler. These are big deal events that are going on. There were also allegations, believe it or not, that foreign officials were trying to rig American elections, both at the local level and at the national level. There were German attempts to buy American newspapers, including H.L. Mencken's The Smart Set, which Mencken refused. There were connections between German agents and Pancho Villa's raid into New Mexico, which Villa bragged about, that the Germans were backing him. Allegations that we think are probably true, are probably accurate. All of this led to a spirit that became known as preparedness. And I love this image, and I hope that some of you in the back can see it. This is an AT&T ad. It says, "We are prepared." In the circle in the bottom left of the ad, of the picture of the ad, is Paul Revere with the year 1775 written under it. And over to the right is an American military staff officer, not unlike the ones that I teach, on the telephone, behind him, a map of the Bell telephone system, and 1916 written. And the text here, I won't read you the text, of course, but what the text says is that the Bell telephone system is the modern equivalent of Paul Revere riding around saying the British are coming. And the text says, we are prepared. Now, preparedness came to mean a lot of things to a lot of people. To people on the right, that is, people more conservative than Woodrow Wilson, it came to mean that if the federal government would not get this country ready for the war that was coming, they would do it themselves. And many of you know about the most famous example of this, which is the so-called Plattsburgh movement of young men, most of them Ivy League and elite young men, going up to Plattsburgh, New York, and other camps to train themselves in how to be officers, with support from men like Theodore Roosevelt. But there were others. There was an American Committee of Industrial Preparedness, led by Powell Evans, a Philadelphia railroad magnate. There was the Committee for Scientific Preparedness, led by a guy named Thomas Edison. There was a Committee for Medical Preparedness, led by a doctor named Charles Mayo of the Mayo Clinic. And there was a University Preparedness Committee. The president of Columbia University, see Ted if this would have flown at Kansas in the last few years, the president of Columbia told every member of the Columbia faculty, this is the way the Army staff is set up. Identify where on the Army staff system you can make a contribution to the nation in time of need. In 1916, they did this. And every single member of the Columbia faculty responded. Every single member. Okay. Now, for reasons that I'd be happy to discuss in the Q&A, if you'd like, preparedness mostly produced half measures, like a slightly larger Navy, an ROTC program at land-grant institutions like Kansas State down the road, and a whole lot of parades. But it did highlight the essential American problem, how to be neutral and keep yourself safe at the same time. What Americans were describing as the fire in the house next door. How to keep yourself protected. One image that I love that you see in political cartoons a lot is a porcupine. That what we'll build is a system where we can defend ourselves, but something that's of no harm to somebody else. But if anything tries to grab us, we'll be ready. Now we have also in the history of this failed to make distinctions that the American people in their own time and day made. This is Willa Cather, winner of the 1920 Pulitzer Prize for a novel One of Ours. The point I want to make here is that little of America's fears, little of America's insecurities translated to the German American population. Germans coming over here, yes. Germans born in the United States know. And the reason that I want to make this case is because Willa Cather wrote the book One of Ours largely to touch on this theme. As she understood, many German Americans in the so-called second wave of German immigration to the United States were non-Prussian and Catholic. That is, they came here to get away from the Prussians. German Americans were also among the most assimilated groups in the United States. Her book, One of Ours, depicted the Wheeler family, which I'm sorry to say was Nebraska, not Kansas, whose son Claude gives up his plan to study in Germany, but never turned his back on the German Americans living around them in Nebraska. How comes it's all them Germans is such ugly-looking people? The Yoders and the German folks around here ain't ugly-looking, asks their housekeeper. The ugly ones are those doing the killing, while the Germans on the home front are nice, like our neighbors, Claude replies. Mary Roberts Reinhardt herself, who had plenty of nativist sympathies, one of the reasons her books are difficult to read these days, wrote about German Americans that they are, quote, not Huns or Vandals. The German we know has come here to escape the very thing that has wrecked the old world. In coming to this land of the free, he has followed an ideal as steadily as back in the fatherland, his kindred are following the false gods of hate and war. America's first German Catholic cardinal, Cardinal George Mundelein of Chicago, picked up this theme as well. In 1916, he wrote, should the U.S. and Germany go to war, the German-American community will support America from the little drummer boy in the orphan asylum to the aged veteran in the old folks' home. In September 1916, he said, it seems to me that it is rather late in the day to ask the German-American to prove his patriotism. He did that more than half a century ago, referring to the American Civil War, where Mundelein's grandfather had fought. Mundelein had a nice little analogy here. He said the conflict between the United States and Germany was like what happens when your wife and your mother argue. Your mother had raised you, but you now live with your wife. And the question he put to the German-American community is, when your wife and your mother argue, who wins? I want to touch a little bit on the Irish-American community, too, and I'll be happy to pick this up a little more if you'd like. In 1914, most Irish-Americans either wanted the United States to stay neutral or actively hoped that something bad would happen to England, using the old Irish Republican motto that England's difficulty is Ireland's opportunity. But the Lusitania made that case hard to make in the United States. It made it hard to make an anti-British statement not look like a pro-German one. The real event that changes all this is the Easter Rising in Dublin in this Easter time 1916. That rebellion was sponsored by Germany, and the Germans left the Irish Republicans essentially out to dry to a massive British reprisal. Now, what happens here is very interesting. Irish-American leaders come out and say, look, we may be anti-German, we still don't like the British, but here's the best case scenario for Ireland. The best case scenario for Ireland is if Woodrow Wilson's ideas about national self-determination actually take root. The best future for Ireland is if the post-war world is based on national self-determination. That won't happen if Germany wins, and it won't happen if England wins unless the United States wins alongside her. That's the only way this is going to happen. Then Woodrow Wilson can go to the peace conference after the war and argue for national self-determination for Ireland. Now, what most Irish Americans didn't know is that Woodrow Wilson did not think the Irish were a nation. He did not. He thought they were already adequately represented through Great Britain. The point that I want to make is that both in the case of Germany and in the case of Irish American and in the case of Jewish Americans, there is a transition from their attitudes at the beginning of the war, which mainly argue for neutrality, to their identities and attitudes by the end of 1916, early 1917, when for reasons both to their American identity and to their quote-unquote ethnic identity, an Allied victory in the war looks like the better option. Okay, so the point that I'm trying to make, and the reason that the book has the subtitle that it has, is that by 1917, Americans of all groups are coming together on a common international vision that was not there in 1914, and arguably was not there in 1915. Now, I couldn't give this lecture without talking a little bit about economics, and I was very happy to find this cartoon from John McCutcheon, who later won one of the first Pulitzer Prizes for editorial cartooning. He drew this one in April 1915. This is called Coming Our Way, and if you look at it carefully, the docks of New York City are literally made of magnets, pulling the hard currency of Europe from the European side over to the American side. Now, remember that I told you that when the war began, the fear was, because the United States currency was backed by gold, that what the great powers would do, they would sell the securities, sell the stocks that they owned, and then take the money out as gold, meaning that the U.S. would quickly run out of gold. That's why the stock market gets shut down. Even in that dark time, however, there are American economic advisors going to Woodrow Wilson, going to J.P. Morgan, and saying, hey, if we play our cards right, we can reorient the global economy to the United States. We can do exactly this. And the rationale ran something like this. There were two rationales. One, the Europeans were going to need whatever the Americans could produce. They were going to need cannon. They were going to need eyeglasses. They were going to need Kansas wheat. They were going to need whatever you could produce. So one thing to do is to make sure that Europe got the things that America wanted to sell. Now, this comes with a moral argument that I want to talk about in just a bit. But from an economic perspective, it seems to make a lot of sense. So just to give you an idea, in 1915, a company called Baldwin Locomotive Works was near bankruptcy. In 1915, it signed a contract for $127 million in railroad equipment with the Russians alone. It then signed a fat deal with the British and French for shells and cartridges, and an equally fat deal with the Pennsylvania National Guard for ammunition and rifles to replace the equipment that they had. With those contracts, of course, came jobs. The second part of this economic argument said that all of the things Americans used to buy from the Europeans, they'll now buy right here in the United States. So everything from Bible salesmen in America see a rapid spike because Americans used to buy their Bibles from Europe. It used to be a very fashionable thing to have a German or a French or a British Bible. I guess not so much French. Pencils, everything that the Europeans used to make are now being made in the U.S. In 1914, the per capita income in the United States was $1,164. 2 years later, American per capita income is $1,868. Yes, the great industrialists and great financiers are making money hand over fist. Everybody's making money. When J.P. Morgan floated these massive loans to the Allies, you can find evidence of German-American businessmen saying, you know, this loan of his, it's going to tie us to the British and French. But boy, can I make a lot of money off of this? So guess what they do? They don't object to the loan. Just to give you another example of what this looks like. In August 1914, the United States had a trade deficit with Europe. Look how quickly that trade deficit turns into a massive trade surplus. This is just to the end of December. Now, the economic point that my friend who's an economist pointed out to me, you have to think of this as 1914, not 2017. In 1914, this trade that you see going on here is going on British ships, insured by British firms, and most of the administration being done by British companies. What that means is America can't do this without Great Britain being a willing participant. Now, what I think is happening here, again, that money end of it is overlapping with what the American people want to do anyway, meaning that the values and the interests aren't in conflict. What it does bring up, though, is the question of whether the United States wants to be the kind of country that makes money off of the suffering of others. And it won't surprise you that a lot of ministers and a lot of religious leaders in the United States are asking exactly this question. If we're making money off of the death in an unprecedented war, what does it say about the United States? And Mary Roberts Reinhart picked this up a little bit, too, when she watched Pittsburgh, which of course in those days could make anything you wanted out of metal, her comment that her hometown was fattening on catastrophe. What do you do about that? Well, one thing the American people did is they gave a lot of that money away. This is a newspaper ad for, again, a Pennsylvania example, and I apologize, from my hometown, from the amusement park that I went to as a kid and still take my kids to. They had a Serbia Day. All the money earned by the park on that day went to Serbian war relief. There was a proposal to have the entire 1916 college football season, every dime earned, given to Belgium. Now, you might not be surprised to find out that university administrators passed on that idea, but they did pass around buckets at every game for people to put money into. Right? Millions and millions of dollars. John Wanamaker, the great Philadelphia industrialist, managed to raise $100 million in World War I money for Belgium alone. Philadelphia held another drive where they raised enough money to support two entire field hospitals for the French army. And in just 3 hours, New York City's Jewish community raised $200,000 for relief in Poland. That's a lot of money that the American people were giving. This is my favorite image that I found when doing the research, and I want to break it down for you a little bit, and I apologize if in the back it's hard to see. This is what I think is the most important thing to understand. This is an image from early February 1916, so very early on, more than a year before the United States is involved in the war. This map is called My Country, Tis of Thee, and it was the cover image of Life magazine that week. And I'll just give you, as the Army would say, the bluff, the bottom line up front. The argument that this map is showing is that neutrality has made the United States less safe, not more safe. And here's the argument. This is what the map is showing. The fear is, and this is very exaggerated, right? You see New Prussia covering most of the United States. There are two cities here called Boy Ed City, after that German attaché, and Von Papen City, roughly where Boise, Idaho is. So it's a little bit, of course, exaggerated. The Gulf of Mexico is called the Gulf of Hate and all this. But let me play this out with you. If France and Britain think they're losing this war, one option is to sign a peace treaty where they give away parts of their North American possessions. And remember, 1914 is when the United States opened the Panama Canal. 1916, the United States bought the Danish Virgin Islands from Denmark because the United States was afraid that Germany would invade Denmark and the price of Denmark's surrender would be those islands. So we bought them to prevent that from happening. William Jennings Bryan, the former American Secretary of State, proposed buying Canada. Remember, Canada is a British colony at this point. Canada is part of Great Britain. The fear that this map is showing is that American neutrality and a German victory could lead to Germany taking over British possessions in the Caribbean, let's say Halifax, Vancouver, Toronto, and creating this encirclement of the United States. Now, I've shown this map in Canada. My Canadian friends always note that Canada is labeled here barbarians. I don't think this is a reference to the Canadians themselves. It is a reference to the possibility that Germany could demand Canada as part of the price of peace. The argument is that neutrality is making us less safe. It is not making us more safe. And remember what I told you about Pancho Villa, the fear that Mexico could become a German ally. And as you all know, about a year from when this is produced, all of these fears are going to become a reality with the publication of the Zimmermann Telegram, in which Germany makes exactly this claim. If war breaks out between Germany and Mexico, the telegram says, Mexico can invade the Southwest and take everything that the United States took from it in the Mexican War. The Zimmermann Telegram also asks Germany to contact Japan about joining this alliance as well. So these fears are out there in the American psyche, and what the Zimmermann Telegram does is seem to prove them. The Baja Peninsula in this example is Austriana. The West Coast is Japonica. I think as much a result of West Coast anti-Japanese racism as anything else. But the Caribbean is a major area of concern. From 1914 to 1917, one of the big projects in the American defense budget is to pay for the defense of Puerto Rico. That Puerto Rico will be the key fortress to prevent the Europeans from coming into the Caribbean. Now, there were some Americans who put more than their money on the line. These men are the Lafayette Escadrille, American volunteer pilots who flew for the French Air Force. And as Ted mentioned, I taught at the Air Force Academy for a while. I have a pet theory that I can't prove, that the fighter pilot culture comes from these guys. They are Americans. They are flying for the French Army, but they're not really subject to the authority of the French Air Force, except that they go where the French tell them to. Otherwise, they live the life they want to live. Most of them are stinking rich. The Vanderbilts give them money. Teddy Roosevelt gives them money. They throw lavish champagne parties. Their squadron mascot is not a kitten. It's a full-blown lion cub. They do what they want, and they're very good at what they do. The point is that they become a living symbol between the United States and France. And you better believe that the PR people in the French army took every advantage of that. This is the monument that they built, the French built, in the Parc des Gardes in western Paris to the Lafayette Escadrille, which they have since, it looks nice there. It didn't used to look nice. They have since really done a nice job of sandblasting it and cleaning it up. Anne Morgan's daughter, Edith Wharton, the granddaughter of Ulysses Grant and the great-granddaughter of Grover Cleveland, all go to France before U.S. entry as volunteer medical personnel. There's a tight connection that's already going on before the United States gets involved. All right, let me wrap up a little bit to make sure we have some time for questions. I only have two more slides, I promise. This is Mary Roberts Reinhart writing in March of 1917, after Germany had said that it would resume submarine warfare and after the Zimmermann telegram had become public knowledge, when American desire for war is strong. She wrote this piece for the Saturday Evening Post before Woodrow Wilson came and asked for that declaration of war, which is that second paragraph I have quoted here. We are virtually at war. By the time this is published, perhaps the declaration will have been made. Massachusetts and New York State had already called out their National Guards and militia. They had already declared that their states were on a war footing. This is before Wilson does anything. America, she says, is the last stand of the humanities on Earth, the realization of a dream, and the fulfillment of an ideal. Since 1914, she argued, Britain and France had been fighting for the ideal on which my country was founded. Under the domination of the Prussians, Imperial Germany now threatened those values, not only in Europe, but in America itself. For Germany had broken loose something terrible, something that must be killed or the world dies. Now, this is not the statement of a woman who is fooled by propaganda. This is not the statement of a woman waiting for Woodrow Wilson to lead her people into something. She couldn't stand Wilson. This is a woman who genuinely had come to believe, from 1914 to 1917, of the need to fight this war. Not the desire, the need. One last slide, and I want to do this to make the point I was making earlier, to reinforce that point. I want to end with the symbolic story of George M. Cohan, who was in the top left there. He wrote the most famous song in American history up to that point, Over Here, which he wrote when taking his daily commute from New Rochelle into Midtown Manhattan in April 1917, after Wilson had asked for the declaration of war. To me, it's symbolic of two very important themes. The first is how far the United States had come in 2 years. In early 1915, one of the most popular songs to come out of New York had been the song, I Didn't Raise My Boy to Be a Soldier, a song that was controversial from the start. Theodore Roosevelt in particular blasted the song. And after the Lusitania, even the guy that wrote the song said, I didn't mean for this to be a statement against preparedness. It's actually an anti-German song. The more important story, I think, is the history of the song itself. It was written by George M. Cohan, an old stock Protestant American. He sang a version of it. And there were three other very famous versions of the song. One sung by Billy Murray, an Irish-American tenor out of Philadelphia. One sung by Enrico Caruso, the famous Italian tenor. And one sung by Nora Bies, born Eleanor Goldberg in Joliet, Illinois. This shows me two things. One, it's symbolic of the way that Americans of all kinds of backgrounds had come together by 1917. It is also symbolic of the segregated society that the United States still was. There was no African-American version of this song, even though the African-American community in the United States followed the same path towards the belief in needing to go to war. What this shows to me is this tremendous transition that's happening in the American culture from 1914 to 1917 that will carry the United States into war, although it doesn't necessarily carry the United States into a shared vision of what the peace ought to look like. Thank you very much, and I'll be happy to take any questions that you might have. We wait for a microphone. There's a question.
Okay. You don't trust me, eh? Why don't we learn this stuff? I mean, I didn't know these things, and I'm a historian. And does this path to war tell me these things?
It does. I hope it does. I have this pet theory that I've been working for a few years, because I have to teach this stuff too. I think there's about a 5-minute way to explain the First World War, And there's a semester way to explain it. There's nothing in between that makes any sense. So in my own view, someone asked me earlier today why the United States doesn't pay attention to this. I think one of the reasons is it is so complex. It is so complicated. It is easier to teach it as, well, Woodrow Wilson kind of had this vision and, you know, the Lusitania got sunk and bang, there we are. Which is basically what my daughter's high school textbook says, right? To get at all this is much more complicated. I also tend to think that we, I was explaining this a little bit at dinner, or pontificating, maybe is the right word, I don't know. The real lessons of the First World War are pretty frightening lessons, which is that it's actually easy to go from a period of stability and peace into a period of war and instability, and that the effects of that instability can last decades. And that's a scary thing. So what I think we tend to do is say, okay, these were people from a long time ago that dress silly and talk silly and wore clothes like that. Let's just put them into a box and let's not worry about it. And that's exactly, of course, the lesson I think. If we come out of the centennial period learning, we will have missed it all. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, could you briefly describe the time frame of the Yellow Barns and what that had to do with us?
Yellow Barns?
Supposedly the German, some of the German immigrants had their barns painted yellow. That's here in Kansas, at least.
I have to confess ignorance on that one.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay. All right. Sort of a follow-up, I think.
On the Yellow Barns or something else?
Something like that, yes. Okay. The Kansas history with, like, the Mennonite, other pacifist groups, people who didn't want to buy war bonds, et cetera, were terrorized. I think Frank Harris even said the Constitution was almost repealed by the First World War. I know this is a different direction than you go, but do you have any comment on the current state versus World War
I? Oh, I have no comment on the current state.
Okay.
And in fact, it might be a good time to say that everything you heard from me tonight is my own personal opinion, not that of the United States Department of Defense, the Department of the Army, or my supervisor, the provost of the U.S. Army War College. What I can say to answer your question maybe is two things. One, there is clearly a difference in mood from the pre-war period and once the United States is involved in the war. Once the U.S. is involved in the war, the dynamic shifts tremendously. The second thing I would argue, and Andrew Preston has done some really groundbreaking work on this with American religious communities, is that by the time you get to late 1916, early 1917, the number of people who are arguing for a strict pacifist position has dwindled to a small handful. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that they want to be a part of the war that follows. But the big group that was there in 1914, the Jane Addamses and others, they are down. Andrew Preston says you can almost identify them as individuals. That's how small the group has become. But when we teach it, we kind of say, and a couple of exhibits, museum exhibits that I've advised on have all done this. Here's this group of people that want to get involved in the war, and then here's this group that's opposed. And the reality is they are, 1914, they might be roughly equivalent. By 1917, they're like this.
Okay. There seems to be one front missing from this.
You only gave me 45 minutes.
Well, and down to February, there's a problem with that front because the government that's conducting the war is not particularly popular in the United States, Tsarism. Mm-hmm. And the February Revolution sort of lets all kinds of people say, oh, the Russians are now Democrats, et cetera.
Yeah.
How do you see that changing U.S. opinion?
Critically important. So the argument in the United States is partly that, yes, the Tsar is gone, good, maybe the Russians will have democracy. The other argument, and the one that plays much more in the American media, is, hey, look, the Civil War was started just to keep the Confederates from doing anything crazy. It did have the positive benefit of destroying slavery. Maybe this war will end up following a similar pattern. If you do get to the end of the war, and Russian Tsarism is gone, the Kaiser is gone, and the Ottomans are gone, there's hope. So it's a different book and a different project and a different lecture, but I do believe what the American people wanted out of this war was really for this to stop. So when we think of the end of World War I, and they did too, they think of November 11th, 1918, when the Germans agree to the armistice. Wilson, of course, has another project, right? So that I don't think most Americans wanted to follow on. So by the time you get to 1920, 21, 22, it's easy to look back and say, well, look, the only real reason for doing this war was if something really good and positive came out of it. And by the late 1920s, early 1930s, it looks like that's not, what comes later is worse. Right? So I hope that kind of gets at your question. But you're absolutely right. The Russian dynamic to this is very important.
I'm slightly going to go back to even the name Jane Addams, you know, mm-hmm. that topic of the actual state of health of a good share of who was in America, you know, the working people of America. If I remember right, when they were to enter this war, they were so unhealthy and their nourishment was poor, you know, even to be drafted into World War I, that there was still tremendous poverty in America mm-hmm. during this period, sure. and that, in fact, my relatives are a part of that poverty, you know, and I heard sure. their stories. They were hungry. So a little bit, why did people want to kill Wilson? Why did people attempt to assassinate him? And speak to that really impoverished person also, you know, that even to be healthy enough to join this war, you know, what was really going on here?
So the first thing, of course, is that American troops, when they get to Europe, look ridiculously healthy to the Europeans. And nobody really knows where the phrase doughboys came from, but one theory is that it's because they look healthy. They look so good compared to the Europeans. The debate against Wilson, I don't think is coming. I think the debate about Wilson in terms of foreign policy, and here there is an echo to what you're hearing today, although that's as much as I'm going to say on that, is the difference between what Wilson wants to do to create a multilateral world and his critics, people like Henry Cabot Lodge, the senator from Massachusetts, and Theodore Roosevelt before his death in 1919, who say, look, America works better when it works alone. America works better apart from that. So I'm not a specialist on progressivism, but I think from the foreign policy perspective, the debate is not class-based. It's on this kind of ideology of where to go next. Anybody else? Yeah, please.
Were the German-speaking newspapers a factor?
The German-speaking newspapers are already in decline by the time of that all this happened. So there is a Harvard psychologist, a guy by the name of Ugo Munsterberg, who is very influential in 1914, who took this case on very seriously, that he was worried that, in his view, what was happening is that the only people who really knew what Germany was going through were the old people from the old world, that the generation born in the United States didn't speak German, didn't care, wasn't interested, all of that. So it is true that once the war begins, the United States government clamped down on some German newspapers, though not all, but it's equally true that was in crisis already. So near as I can figure, and I haven't done an in-depth study of German newspapers, but there are scholars who have, and the conclusion that most of them reach is that the vast majority of German newspapers and German-American communities have accepted the necessity of war by the time you get to 1917. So that Oswald Villard, who's one of the most famous of the German language journalists, writes a piece in late 1916 in which he says, look, I really wish that this weren't happening, but if it means that the Prussian government is destroyed, it will be good for Germany in the long run. We can accept it if the Kaiser goes away and Germany gets a democracy. And that becomes a dominant view by the end of 1916.
Newspaper reporter, so I'm going to take my prerogative to sneak in two questions.
Sure.
I apparently went to the same public schools as the woman who asked the first question. Could you give us a little more information on the Zimmerman telegram?
Sure. Sure.
And the second, on the Irish, I'm curious. I was in Dublin a year ago, July, mm-hmm. at a wonderful museum. A great Irish philanthropist was killed on the Lusitania. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, did that have any influence whatsoever on the Irish-Americans?
So your first question about the Zimmerman telegram is a fascinating one. So as this map shows, this fear of encirclement is already there. So in January, February 1917, the British intercept this telegram that is from the German government in Berlin to the German legation in Mexico. And that telegram runs through the United States. It's the only way physically to do it, but it's a diplomatic cable, so the US isn't supposed to read it. So the British crack it, and they say to the United States, hey, look, they're trying this on you. They're going to go to war with you. They're going to invite Mexico to invade you from the south, and they're going to invite Japan to come in from the west. And the first American reaction is, no way, we're not that stupid, we're not falling for that. What the British do, which is actually really smart, they leak to the press, not the version of the telegram that goes Germany to the US, but the version that went US to Mexico. And the theory is, this way the Germans won't know that the British have broken their codes, they'll blame the Mexicans, which is exactly what happens. So there's a press conference in Berlin. Arthur Zimmerman, the author of this thing, reporters say to him, look, did you really write this thing that the British are reporting on? And Zimmerman figures, they've got me. There's no point covering it up. This way I can openly negotiate with Mexico and Japan. So he says, yeah, I did. I wrote it. This is what we're going to do. We're going back to unrestricted submarine warfare. And if the Americans come in, this is what we're going to do. And the American people go nuts. Even the people that had been the most suspicious that the Germans were dumb enough to actually do this come out and say, okay, this is an act of war. And the other thing that it does, of course, is it takes the American Southwest, which had been the most isolationist part of the country, and now puts them right in the crosshairs. So the Zimmerman telegram's a big deal. But I think it's a big deal in part because it reinforces something that's already there. It doesn't create it out of whole cloth. And your second question about the Irish-Americans on the Lusitania is partly, I mean, the Lusitania victims wash up in Ireland. That is, some of the dead bodies literally wash up in Ireland. So the ship is just off the coast of Ireland. I don't think that's a dominant factor in Irish-American opinion. What they're more worried about, and this is true of Jewish-Americans too, they want to make it clear that they are Americans first and Irish or Jewish second. So they're not going to do anything that's going to threaten the integrity of the United States or anything like that. And the Irish are particularly concerned about this notion that there is a quote-unquote Irish vote that's out there, that the Irish all vote together. So I don't know if the Lusitania itself does that, but this idea of Americanness among the Irish. So the reason I make such a big deal about this in the book is that we've typically written this as the government wants 100% Americanism and then forces everybody to act in a certain way. And I actually think it's coming from the bottom up. It's people, it's German Americans, Irish Americans, Jewish Americans, mostly born in the US by this point, who are saying, look, our identities are as Americans. That may differ on the margins from the other people around us, but we're Americans. So I actually think it's coming the other direction. Yeah, sorry.
Just a quick question. As a result of all your study, to what extent do you think the sphere among American financiers and industrialists, they might lose their shorts and all these loans they had to the Allied powers if Germany were to win? To what extent did that influence American decision-making in declaring war or going to war?
So I actually, this is a complicated question that you've asked. Circumstantially, that would seem to be it, right? J.P. Morgan is leveraged up to his eyebrows. If the Allies don't win, he doesn't get his money. I can't actually find any evidence that that's true. So I can find evidence where J.P. Morgan is saying, look, I can loan this money. This is the risk that I'm undertaking, that I won't get the money back, but I'm rich enough, I can do it. I can't actually find any evidence. I can find evidence the other way, which is to say that the major financiers of the United States despised Wilson, didn't really even want to be in the same room with him. Edward House, Wilson's great advisor, when he moved to New York City, moved as far away from Wall Street as he could get without being in the wilderness of Manhattan. Right? Because he didn't want the image that he was talking to these financiers. So while that case ought to be able to make it, I can't actually make it. I'm getting the hook. Oh, okay.
Thank you. Thanks, Professor Neiberg, for a really great talk. Given how you're sort of retelling the story of the years before the war, I'm wondering if you would speak a bit about how you think your version shapes our sense of the post-war years, and especially that post-war disillusionment.
Yeah.
How does it change our sense of post-war disillusionment if it's really coming from the bottom up?
So what I really think is happening, and I think I didn't, the book stops when the US gets in the war, but what I really think is happening, the American people want this to stop. So November 11th, 1918, what do most Americans say? War's over, bring everybody home. I don't want my son, brother dying of influenza. The war's over, it's done, right? The United States is much more ambivalent about what it should do in Europe going forward. And here I think you can see parallels that run all the way through the rest of the 20th and into our own day. How much do you really want to be a part of the world? How much have you actually now owned part of this? So one of the things that happens in the post-war period at the Paris Peace Conference, the French and British are very anxious to get the United States to take a part of what was Turkey, Eastern Turkey, as an American kind of colony or mandate. And Wilson says, absolutely not. That's not the vision that I have for the United States. But it sparks a debate back into the United States. What do you want to do then? And I don't think anybody really knows. So Wilson writes up the 14 points. If you ever want to do this, if you're as much of a nerd as I am, you can look at the 14 points, read them through one time as if you're British or French, and you're going to hate them. Right? Georges Clemenceau said God himself was content to give us just 10. Then read them through as if you're German, and they make a lot of sense. They make a lot of sense. So the legacy I think that this leaves is there is this ambivalence about what America's role in the world really ought to be. Theodore Roosevelt, Henry Cabot Lodge are saying, look, you have a chance to reorient the world using American power. Do it so that we're at the center of all of this. And then you have this very different Wilsonian view that says we have to blend our values and our interests together in a way that either inspires people or infuriates them, depending on how you feel about Wilson. But I think it creates this ambivalence that I think we're still dealing with as we make the adjustment between two presidential administrations that are very much the intellectual inheritors of those two opposite positions.
With that, let's give a round of applause to Dr. Neiberg. Thank you.
Thank you.
And again, I would say round of applause for Dr. Wilson as well. Thank you. All right.
I hope you will
join us next Thursday, February the 9th, for part two. Remember, it's a four-part series. Also, we have a book signing in the back of the room, so you can purchase a book, and you can have it signed by the artist as well. So thank you so very much for coming. Safe travels home.